Well, hello. What a world we live in. Crazy, just to think about all that's going on around us with life, with the COVID stuff, and with elections and all that. And yet our hope in all this, always for us who have come to know the Lord Jesus, is in Him, first and foremost. Whatever happens in this world around, our hope is not based upon politics. Our hope isn't even based upon medicine and science. It's on the strength and power of our Lord Jesus. And we just need to take times to worship Him. And this is, as Michael and I do some songs here, and it's been good to have Michael here for these last couple months. See, he heads off down to Texas. We want to turn our hearts towards our Lord and Savior Jesus. So we'll start that with, first off with some prayer. Let's bring ourselves before Him. Father, we do come before You. You are God. We thank You that You are rock solid, that You are the constant in all the things that are going around here, that You are indeed the Alpha and Omega, who was and is and will ever be. You are God. And Lord, help us to find times in our lives to orient ourselves to You, to worship You and glorify You. And we come before You in Jesus' name. To God to worship, and just like the air we breathe, we breathe in and out worship as we come and enter time with Him. And we're not always there, certainly, but we can get there sometimes. And just this song really expresses that. This is the air I breathe. Song, All the Poor and Powerless. Again, a song of prayer and coming before the Lord. At different times in our lives, we all feel poor. We feel powerless. What's going to happen? What's next? And we can reach out and sing hallelujah to our God. We can cry out to Him and know that He's there. He'll always be there. And the call for us is to maintain that focus on Him. Our first love, we'll be talking about that in the message in a little bit, is we look at the first of the churches in Revelation. But come before Him wholeheartedly, all the poor and powerless.
These will come confess
before you. The great and awesome one. And we can sing it, we can scream it from the mountains. Go tell it on the mountains that Jesus is Lord. And you've come to us. You've called us to yourself. Lord, sometimes we're full of ourselves. Sometimes we're weak. But you're always there. And you always are dependable. Lord, guide us and direct us. Lord, in this day, as we come, as we look at your word, may you speak to us. As we consider the words you have through John, the apostle, and the words of the revelation, your call for us, as to the other churches, is to check out where we're at. Lord, help us to look at ourselves as individuals, but also as a faith community. To put ourselves before you, to pour ourselves out before you, and to remember you first and foremost in our lives. Lord, we don't want to be people who just rest on the laurels and the accomplishments of our past. But to this day and every day, always have our focus on you. Guide us and direct us. In Jesus' name, amen.
When I was just a little bit over 30, I was in my sixth year of youth ministry, and I started having some persistent problems with my knee. Some years before this, I had hurt it playing basketball, and I went to the ER, and they said it was sprained, so give it some rest, and eventually it got better, and I'd go through these periods where it would be good, and then I'd flare it up again, and then I'd have to rest it, and well, eventually it started getting pretty bad. I would get this massive shooting pain in my knee, and it would just buckle my knee, and I'd just fall to the ground. Really not the coolest thing when you're walking around. The clever part of me decided I probably should see someone about this. So I went to see a guy named Dr. Jim Minico. He was a orthopedic guy in Milwaukee, and first session with him, he has me lay down, and he grabs my lower leg and my upper leg, and he just does this little thing with his hands, and right there he says, "Yep, I know what it is. You have got a torn ACL." And just by feeling that out, he knew. He'd been working on knees for years and years and just could tell what was going on. Well, he had an MRI done just to see what was going on there, what's happening inside, and sure enough found, along with that, the torn anterior cruciate ligament. He's also found some badly torn cartilage that needed to be fixed as well. So this was pretty obvious, but it's pretty obvious to me I had a problem, and the solution was pretty clear too. Surgery was needed to repair this. But you know, sometimes health-wise, it's not so obvious, and sometimes doctors can be befuddled about giving a correct diagnosis, and sometimes we don't even know anything's going on in our life, which is why sometimes we go to a doctor for a regular health checkup to see where things are at, get some tests and see what's happening inside of us. And during those times, that sometimes a diagnosis of something that's not okay, that if we missed it, it would be worse, but it could be tackled on pretty quickly. That's the health checkup. Well, needed with the church as well. I've called this series the Church Health Exam, and it's has this direction of looking at our church and looking at our churches in general and saying, are we okay? As the Church of Jesus Christ, you know, we got a pretty good thing going. The God of the universe loves us, and it calls us to know him and follow him, and this is awesome, right? And most times in most churches are pretty good, but sometimes something's wrong, and the church has injuries or illnesses that just can't be put off indefinitely. And we need a checkup. We need someone who knows what's right to look at what's going on in us. So in the book of Revelation, Jesus addresses several churches and gives them assessments about where each of them were at. Each of these churches was in the region the apostle John was living. And so Jesus gives him a message for each of these seven churches in that region. John was exiled on the island of Patmos, which is about 35 miles off the coast of where Ephesus was, in the Aegean Sea. And as he's worshiping, this message comes to him, and it's revealed to him. And we looked at that chapter 1 and how all of this comes before him, and he sees Jesus, and he's just blown away, and he falls down. But then Jesus says, write this down. And what happens next is we get these seven letters in chapters 2 and 3 of the book of Revelation. And it, having seen the broad view of who Jesus is, and that's one of the things we see in chapter 1 as well, is that Jesus, who he is, his power, his authority, as well as God's intention to reveal what must soon take place. The last verse we looked at kind of leads into us, giving us some of the symbolism that's going on, and that's will be important in a minute here. It ended with this: the mystery of the seven stars that you saw in my right hand and of the seven golden lampstands is this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So you got seven stars, which are angels, and seven lampstands, and those are the churches. And I've been reading through some commentaries of what are the angels there. Are the angels actually that are protecting them? And possibly not, because it seems like each of these angels, and the word angel really is a word that means messenger. And so it could be the person who reads this to the church that John sends this to, or it could be the pastor of the church. And Chuck Swindoll, in his commentary, he thinks that probably the pastor or the bishop of that particular region, bringing the message to each of the particular churches. So first we're going to look at the city of Ephesus. It was the closest to where John was in Patmos, and it kind of goes in a geographical order that kind of you can go a line and one to the other and get to each of them. Well, this is the first of them. This is in Revelation chapter 2, starting in verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So again, one way of looking at this is looking at Jesus, the great physician, as the doctor coming and giving a diagnosis to the church. And who of all will know these best? Well, we get some of the picture here, even of who Jesus is, even in the context with each of these churches. He's the one holding the seven stars. And so if the seven stars represent the angels, and the angels are the pastors or leaders there, and the seven lampstands, the churches themselves, as he considers these particular seven churches, he knows the angels of them. And it says he walks among the seven golden lampstands. He walks among them and he knows them. Our Lord knows his churches. He sees them and is in their midst and is able to say the things that are going on. And one of the things that happens here in each of these particular letters to the seven churches, one of the descriptions we had of Jesus, which we see in chapter 1, verses 12 to 16, gets brought up again here. And so this idea of the seven stars in the right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands, he brings that back, and that'll happen in each of these letters. But we have the authority. The expert comes, the one who knows. You know, it's good to have a resume for someone who's going to give you advice, a track record. That's important with authorities. We see that these days too, right? When people want to state, this is what we need to do as we go through this crisis over this last year. And it was like, well, experts say this. Well, who is more expert to talk about the condition of a church than our Lord himself, the bridegroom of the bride, the church? So Jesus and his messengers, the angels, you have this sense that the message is coming from God to Jesus, to John, to the particular churches through the angel that is there or the pastor. And yet the message is for everyone. And again, he's walking among them. And as this starts off, we get some pretty healthy stats. The doctor starts off with some descriptions. These are some things that are going really well for you. And he brings up three things in particular. He says, he notes that I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. You have been working and striving for my name and for the ministry here. Now, the Church of Ephesus is one that we can know a fair bit about. If we look in Acts chapter 19, we see that Paul was there for some time. Actually, spent most of his time, or more than anywhere else, of all the ministries he had. 2.5 to 3 years he ministered in Ephesus. We also have a letter that he wrote to the church in Ephesus. We also have two letters he wrote to the guy who replaced him, or he left in charge of the ministry in Ephesus, Timothy, 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy. And it's considered that at some time after Timothy finished his ministry, John the Apostle came and he ministered to Ephesus before he went to be exiled. And so there's a fair bit about it. So they worked hard. And if we remember some of the stories from Acts chapter 19 and some of the things that happened, there were some confrontations there. And they went through some difficult times. And one of the things is that they persevered. They went through some difficult things. Verse 3 says, you have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. These are some of the things that Jesus says, this is what you've done positively. You've worked hard, you've cared for the poor, you cared for those in need, and this is great, and you've endured stuff. In the middle of that, he also talks about how they cannot tolerate wicked people. They stood for what was right, and they stood for solid teaching. Apparently, some people came and said, I am an apostle. Instead of just taking their word for it, they spent some time with them and talked with them and were able to discern. And those whose theology was wrong and they were trying to lead people away from truth, they were able to see that and stop it right in its track. There's this reference later to how they have this in their favor as well. This is in verse 6. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. I think getting back to this, keeping purity within the faith community. Who are the Nicolaitans? It's really not known. There's a lot of conjecture about what it was. Possibly a play off the word Nikolaos. Niko is to conquer, and Laos is people in Greek. And so those who have conquered the people, but really there's no certain. They're a group that came in and they had practices. We'll see them actually later in the letter to Pergamum as well. But Jesus commends them for staying solid to the truth and to what they were taught by Paul and Timothy and John. And they stayed steadfast. They worked hard on behalf of the kingdom of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, and they faced all kinds of difficult things. Again, if you recall from Acts chapters 19 and 20, things happened there, and there was lots of destruction, and they got kicked out of the city, and there was persecution because they were a threat to the local gods, and particularly the silversmiths who were making statues of Artemis, the goddess Artemis, also called Diana, and there was concern that they were usurping what was going on there, and so they faced all kinds of persecution because of that. But Jesus says, you endured this, you walked through this, well done. And so those are the healthy stats, but the doctor doesn't ignore some things that are right out there and need to be addressed. And he says, you know what, there's some things I have against you. And the thing that he finds and discovers in them and brings out to them is that they've forsaken their first love. Now, who the love is it the people of God or God himself? Probably some of both for sure. But as he talks with them and notes the things that they do well, some part of them is a little bit off in how they're living this out. And it has to do with their hearts. Somehow they're not loving one another, or they're not loving the Lord as much as they used to. You've maybe seen this or even experienced this at some points in your life, how when you think back to who you were when you came to faith in Jesus and you joined a fellowship and they were telling you about Jesus, and like, this is great, this is the best, and you were filled with enthusiasm and you just couldn't wait and you wanted to set your whole schedule around being able to gather with these people whom you love and to spend time worshiping God who loves you. And he says, you've forsaken that. There's other things have gotten in your way. You know, it's possible even that their adherence to good teaching and solid right teaching, maybe that kind of attentiveness to being right caused them on some level to be a little bit calloused in how they treated others. But whatever it is, and it's something that undoubtedly they would be able to recognize in their own hearts, Jesus gives them a remedy for this as well and directs them to what needs to happen. And the remedy is to remember. Verse 5 says, consider how far you have fallen. What does that mean? Remember where you were. Look at where you're at now and compare yourself when you were young in the faith and when you had so much love and care for others. Repent and do the things you did at first. You know, sometimes it's good to be reminded of, this is where I used to be. This is who I used to be. Am I that way anymore? This week, I was taking Michael down to Milwaukee for a plane, and I saw on Facebook the other day, one of my former students was just kind of crying out, going through some troubled times and some difficulties, and I had an opportunity to reach out and say, hey, I'm going to be in Milwaukee tomorrow night. Do you want to get together? And so we got together Thursday night and grabbed some dinner and talked a little bit about. And one of the first things, he comes up and gives me just a huge hug and said, you know what? You are the one that was there for me. That's the thing I remember about you, Rick. And he had spent some troubled time, was in a detention center for quite some time, and said, you were the only one to visit me there. And you had just the biggest impact on my life, and I looked blown away by the emotion and the fervor with which he said that. And I was like, well, I don't know about that. He's like, are you telling me that you didn't have an impact in my life? I'm telling you, you did. And it caused me to think, who was I back then? What did I do? What was driving me? And to ask myself as well, am I doing things, maybe not exactly like that, but do I continue to look out and care for others? I think that's one of the things that Jesus is calling the church in Ephesus to do, is say, where were you? Remember who you were. Remember how this just infused every part of your life. And then he says, repent, which means to turn around and go back and get back there. Go the other way. And do the things that you did at first. It's a call for the church to think and reconsider and put themselves back in a place with him. And not without a little bit of warning here. And it goes on to say, if you do not repent, I will come and remove your lampstand from its place. Which is, you know, if we understand the symbolism of the lampstand, is the church. Is he going to remove the church? Well, it seems to be what he's talking about. We have from some of the other later letters that this church did turn around and was thriving and strong again for many years, was a bastion of Christian truth and ministry for many years. But you go through that area now, there's no churches there. The church is gone. It's been removed. And as we think about and apply this in our world, there are churches that were really strong and really good, done amazing things for years and decades, and yet there's lots of them that aren't there anymore. You know, sometimes we'll look at it as like, you know, we're doing great. You know, we'll never fail. We'll never turn our backs on the Lord. And you know what? Nothing's too big to fail. No church, no pastor, no ministry. It doesn't take us too long in our world to think of prominent ministries that have been decimated because of their failure to keep themselves focused upon their first love and have allowed other things in their lives or in their ministry to distract them. And I think the message here is for each of us as churches, but also as individual followers of the Lord, to orient ourselves again towards this first love we have for our Lord Jesus and for our faith community. Well, we've certainly seen churches that have, and people that have walked away from the faith or from churches because of disagreements. And yet the people of God, what is our call? What does Jesus say we're to be? A new command I give you, he says in the Gospel of John. Love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. And this way all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. This is the defining characteristic of a follower of Jesus. And this church here has dropped the ball. And we could probably think of ways that we have dropped the ball, that we have not treated one another with care and love. It's not to say that we poo-poo sin and we allow heresies and bad theology to go, but to find ways to care and love, if someone needs to be addressed or rebuked, to do it, understanding that we want to save a brother or a sister and continue a relationship with them. How can we continue to do these things? Again, that Jesus' direction here is the consequences. I won't let it go on forever. For us as members of this church to think through, what is it that we need to continue to focus on? Or what do we need to reorient ourselves to? How do we need to revive or renew what has been part of us in the past? Well, I think these are important questions for us to have before us. Well, it doesn't end the letter there. It continues on, finishes, and really has a call to press forward. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Are your ears open? Can you listen to a diagnosis of where we're at? Can we do that as a faith community? Or do we get our hackles up and anytime someone says negative, we just immediately shut it off? That's certainly a tendency for all of us. But to spend some time listening and considering, as well where we've been and what the Lord needs to do in us. You know, we need honest and loving truth about where we're at, and so we can continue to stay faithful. There's a story of the O'Learys and the McMillans. The O'Learys and McMillans, they lived as neighbors at the turn of the last century, before electricity. Well, one day a young man in a suit came to their village to explain that they would have electricity for the first time in their lives. So, well, the McMillans, they responded with typical enthusiasm and filled out all the appropriate papers to have their house wired. Well, the O'Learys were a little cautious. They're like, well, let's just see if this goes anywhere. After all, they'd lived for generations without electricity, and they managed just fine. They weren't about to throw money after every passing fad, so they decided to wait. If electricity was as good as everyone said, they could always get it later. So in the week that followed, the McMillans busily prepared their house for electrical power. They clamped wires and sockets to the walls and hung bulbs from the ceiling. And when the big day finally came, the McMillans invited their neighbors, including the O'Learys, to a grand lighting party. And with dramatic flourish, Mr. McMillan threw a switch and the bulbs began to glow for the first time. The McMillan house was illuminated more brightly than it ever had been lit before. And there was a gasp. "How lovely," someone said. And then there was another gasp. "How filthy," someone also said. It was true. No one had noticed in the dim light previously, but years of oil lamps had left a film of dingy soot over everything. The walls were grimy, there were cobwebs in the corner, and dust covered the floor. Well, the O'Learys, looking at this, said, "We are never going to get electricity in our house. They would never want to suffer the humiliation of having their dirty home exposed to the light." Well, after the party, the McMillans went to work, and now, with all this light, they scrubbed the soot off the walls and the ceiling, and they cleaned the cobwebs and swept away the dust. They sure had been embarrassed by their dirty home when the lights came on. But within a day, their house was cleaner than it had ever been. Meanwhile, the O'Learys continued to live comfortably in their dimly lit home, filled with soot, cobwebs, and filth. We can choose to live in the dark. We can choose to not have things shine upon us that are going to expose things that we just as soon not be seen. Except the Lord's going to address it with us at some point, isn't he? No amount of avoidance is ever going to be able to avoid the Lord who walks among us. The light has come into the world. And he's shining in our lives. The great physician wants to come and bring healing to us. Will we listen to that? What's going on in your life? What's going on or not going on within our ministry and fellowship? Where do we need to think through again how we revive that first love? Well, these certainly are challenges for us. And this first church among the trek of seven gives us ample things to think about, to consider, and to pray, and ask the Lord to lead and guide us. Would you pray for us as well? For us as leaders in the church, as we try and make our way in a strange world right now, but always fixed upon our overriding vision of bringing the gospel to people that they may know the Lord Jesus. And maybe you have ideas and thoughts about how we can do that and revive that. Because this is all of us. This is our community. And yet, we are the people of God. As his church, Jesus is our bridegroom. And it's him who we walk with, guides us. And maybe at some point says, there's some areas you need to repent. Well, let's go before the Lord and pray. Our Father, we do come before you. And Lord, as we look at this letter and consider the words you have for them and certainly great things of what they've done and how they've been energetic in their ministry for you, how they've been so focused on maintaining the purity of their faith and their doctrine and how even they have walked through very difficult things and persecution. But Lord, this losing their first love, Lord, help us to look at our own lives and to continue to do the strong things that we have done, but never lose sight of you, our relationship with you, our devotion to you, and our care for one another. Lord, may we honor you with our lives, with our ministries, with all that we have. We bring this before you through Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, God bless you this day.